So that's like a screenshot from NetExport. So I will kind of talk a little bit about NetExport towards the end of the talk. But if you actually look at it, there's a GET request happening on, so this is a screenshot of NetExport when I'm loading jQueryUI.com, right? So when I'm just making a GET request to jQueryUI.com. And when you actually look at it, that's the first 20%, right? So if you're actually talking about writing performance compliant server code, so that's what you're actually designing for. So all the Java code, all the Ruby code, all the Python code, all the Perl code, everything else that you write on the server only contributes to that little bit, right? But there's a whole lot of other stuff that you're kind of dealing with to kind of make this code look good. And this is what we're going to talk about. We're not going to be talking about that because that's kind of out of scope. But we will be talking about, so if you look at this, there's a whole lot of JavaScript, there's a whole lot of images, there's a whole lot of CSS kind of being loaded over here, right? So this is what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about how we are going to actually tackle this significant 80% and how we are going to make that kind of lighter to handle, right? So HTTP request. So one of the key things to ensure like faster web pages, you know, responsive web pages is to minimize the number of HTTP requests, right? And that's by far like the most simple thing that you can do. But that's not like the largest impact, right? So there are other things, but this is like kind of profound when it comes to performance, right? So most of y'all must have heard about this stuff, right? So you talk about, you've heard of minification, you've heard of compression, right? So there are several tools that you use to kind of compress and minify JavaScript or CSS. So the most popular of them being YUI Compressor and JSMin. JSMin is obviously by Crockford. So you can kind of look up JSMin on javascript.crockford.net. So what this does for you is it only reduces the size of your assets, right? So it doesn't do anything else. It doesn't reduce the number of, well, yeah. Combining assets will reduce. So assuming that, we looked at this slide, right? So you have a jQuery min.js. So if you actually look, there should be a jQuery UI somewhere. Okay, if it's not there, no worries. Usually jQuery UI loads with, so if you've used jQuery, there's one huge library file, right? So that's actually a whole bunch of other individual widget components that's being compressed into one file. So if you're looking at the development version, then you'll look at a whole lot of uncompressed, separated components. So if you're going to load all of those, you're going to have like a whole, like maybe 10 or 15 requests being fired, one being fired for each asset that you want to load. So every asset that you load fires one HTTP request. So what we're trying to do here is we're going to try to minimize the number of HTTP requests that are going to be fired. So to do that, we need to minimize the number of assets that are loaded, right? So how do we do that? We're going to kind of compress assets. We're going to ensure that we combine a whole lot of JavaScript in one file so that we're getting a whole lot of functionality with just one HTTP request, right? So that's what this is about. And you can do the same thing with CSS. There's a very interesting technique with images. So if you're actually using a lot of images in your website, what most people are, rather, some people, I suppose, still do is they use images as image tags or things like that, right? So individual images. But images are like any other asset. So images are like another JS file or another CSS file. So it's just another individual asset. So to fetch every individual image, whether you're using it as part of an image tag or you're using it as part of a background or as part of a CSS root, it's got to make a HTTP request to kind of fetch that image down for you, right? What you can do is you can combine images into something called a sprites. So you have like a transparent background, or you have a white background or a black background or whatever it is that fits the need of your application. And you combine a whole bunch of images and you put them into that huge larger image, right? And what you can do is you can reference each image in that sprite by using something called as a background position, right? So there are CSS properties that you can use to ensure that you display only that one tiny icon or image or whatever else it is that you're going to kind of use, right? So if you want to actually look at that, if you want to actually see that in work, you can look at jQuery UI's development bundle. So they have like a whole bunch of image sprites. So you'll have a whole bunch of icons like delete and accept and arrows and trash cans and whatnot, right? So anything that you probably need for a web application, you'll probably find in that asset sheet. And that's like one of the best examples of image sprites. We'll talk a little bit about image sprites a little later, but that is one of the best examples of image sprites, right? So that's minification. So this is what we were kind of talking about, right? So minimize request overhead and enabling HTTP people like. So if you work with web servers or web server configurations or things like that, so you know that every request that you make is one connection, right? So when you make a connection, you configure your web server to keep that connection alive for a certain amount of time, right? Now if that's a problem with performance, if you're actually talking about that being a problem with server performance, saying I can't really use a keep alive or something like that, maybe you can set your keep alive timeout to something like maybe 10 or 15 seconds or something like that, right? So that kind of, so what does this do? If you actually keep that connection alive, you can actually avoid the additional overhead of a sync ACK handshake between the server and the client, right? So even if you are making a couple of HTTP requests, an additional HTTP request, you will avoid that additional overhead of a handshake, right? So that's what that's how you kind of keep your connection alive. And of course, the most common thing to do would be to kind of compress your content. So what I'm going to be talking about is more specific with respect to patching, but I'm sure you have equivalent features in IIS or in Lite HTTPD or in Nginx or whatever else it is that you're kind of using, right? So compressing content is, you gzip your assets to kind of pass it down to the client, and then your browser knows that it needs to kind of unzip that content. So what that does for you is that it will reduce your payload size. So if you have like a 240 kilobyte asset, which is like jQuery, I think jQuery 1.7 is about 240 KB uncompressed, right? Development version is about 240 KB. I was just looking at it this morning. After compression, it kind of goes down to about 72 KB, right? So a fair rule of thumb is you can comfortably expect to knock off like a good 2/3 of your weight, asset weight, by compressing, right? I'm not so sure about image files, but this figure is like more or less applicable to CSS and JS files, right? So I'm not sure about the image compression, but it will definitely make a difference, right? So I mean, it might not be like a 2/3 advantage, but it might be definitely something that will contribute to, right? So how many of you all have heard of pipelining? So if you've actually heard of something called as pipelining, what you can do is you can pipeline several HTTP requests into one connection, and you can kind of pipeline that so that the server understands them, and it will kind of send them back to you in the order that you kind of ask them. But the problem with this is that it's not really supported by browsers, right? Not too many browsers actually support pipelining, so you have a problem there. I think Opera does. From what I've read, I think Opera 10 does support pipelining. I think maybe earlier versions of Opera also support pipelining, I'm not sure. But most browsers don't, right? Most browsers don't support pipelining, and so you can't really expect to achieve something like this on a regular browser with a regular configuration. But there is a workaround to this, right? So when you're actually talking about pipelining, you can't make multiple HTTP requests with the same, like, you can't pipeline the request. So what can you do to kind of ensure that parallel requests are filed? So the reason, okay, I kind of forgot to mention this, but the reason we're actually talking about pipelining is because browsers have a hard-coded limit of the number of HTTP, simultaneous HTTP concurrent connections that they can actually make to a server, right? So I believe the HTTP 1.1 spec says it's 2, right? But most browsers kind of violate that. No, I believe the specification says 2, but I think that's kind of violated by most browsers. So no browser really follows that spec. I think most browsers, yeah, like she said, it's 6 for most other browsers, and I think IE it's still 2. I think Opera fires about 8 concurrent connections at the same time. So I think you can have 8 HTTP requests firing at the same time, right? So what we're trying to do is, our ultimate goal here is to kind of reduce the time that it takes to load a page, right? So and to load a page completely, we need our assets. So what we're trying to do again is we're going to try to kind of reduce that overhead, and we're doing that. So we said that pipelining doesn't really work. So what's our alternative? Our alternative would be, one alternative is to deploy on an asset server which has several host names. I'm not sure of the terminology. So the lady there says it's sharding, right? It's called sharding. Yeah. So what you're doing is you're actually setting an alias for an asset server, or your asset server has several aliases, right? And you are actually fooling your browser into believing that you're making HTTP requests to different domains. But you're not actually doing that, you're just making requests to the same domain. You could make different requests to a different domain if you choose to, but, well, that's entirely optional. So what you would be doing is you would be setting an alias, right? So you might fetch your JavaScripts from, say, static1.js.com, and you might fetch your CSS from static2.html CSS dot whatever, example.com or whatever else it is your site is kind of, however else you kind of configure your asset servers, right? So so that's a little bit about sharding, actually. So this is what I was talking about, right? So the static content from asset servers. And there's no real hard rule on the number of simultaneous connections you can fool your browser into firing, right? So you can fool your browser into firing like maybe 10 concurrent requests or 20 concurrent requests. There's no real hard rule to that, but a good rule of thumb is like 4, right? Most people say 4. I haven't really tried firing 8 or 10 concurrent requests personally, but the rationale behind this is that every request that you fire actually costs you a DNS income, right? And the whole network overhead of your OS overhead of actually firing those connections and maintaining those connections and so on and so forth, right? So the benefit that you see if you there's no real benefit. What I'm trying to say is that you won't really see a benefit if you fire more than 4 concurrent requests, right? So if you're talking about firing 20 concurrent requests, saying okay, I'm going to get down a whole bunch of asset files at the same time, you won't really. It'll probably take longer to kind of load than if you use maybe 2 concurrent requests or 3 concurrent requests. So ideally, it's between 2 and 4, right? So most people fool their browsers into firing between 2 and 4 concurrent requests. So that's about sharding. We move on to talking a little bit about caching, right? So how do you actually? So one of the other key things that you can do to ensure that your site behaves better is to aggressively cache everything on your browser, right? So that's like one of the most short ways of kind of ensuring performance. So what happens when you actually cache is that one is your whole network overhead is kind of reduced. So which kind of ensures that your page loads much faster, right? So how do you? So this is again like this is not a screenshot from jQuery UI, it's a screenshot from jQuery.com, a screenshot of NetExport from jQuery of jQuery.com. So if you look at this, my cache is empty, you're actually seeing 200, status 200s all over the place, right? And the page load, I believe, is about 164, if I'm not mistaken, something around that. I can't really read from here. It's about 166 KB, right? And it's taking me about 5.45 seconds to kind of load. I can't really read those figures there, but yeah. So, and if you look at this, this is a screenshot of the same thing after I've made the when I'm making the request the second time, right? So if you actually look at it, I'm actually fetching about 145 KB from cache, and you're seeing a whole bunch of 304s, which is a not modified header, which means that the content really hasn't changed. I don't know why the jQuery.com page itself is not there's no expiry header set on that page for some strange reason, because as far as I know, it's more or less static, right? So how do you do this? And I'll kind of run you through a little bit of Apache configuration and how to kind of do this stuff. A related side effect of actually caching pages is that if you're actually looking at a whole bunch of not so savvy computer users, they don't really know that their cache is kind of they don't know about things like cache expiry and clearing the cache and things like that. So if you do intend on kind of making frequent changes to your website, right? So how do you kind of ensure that your cache is kind of I don't know what auto versioning is, but essentially you deploy onto a separate sub URI, right? So you change the version number of your sub URI and automatically once the URL changes, your cache automatically changes, right? So the browser knows that it's a different URI, it's a different asset, it needs to fetch it out, right? So that's great. So if anyone has any questions, you can just like stop me. Yeah.
How do you decide caching? What content do you want to cache? Because there has to be a certain amount of leeway. How much you can cache
on the client side? There's no real hard limit on how many assets you can kind of cache on your client side. I think that's more or less dependent on how much of space you have on your hard disk and things like that. But what you are going to cache, well, that's kind of dependent on the application that you're kind of writing or the application in question, right? So if you do know that, so essentially the rule of thumb is that most JavaScript, CSS and images can be cached because chances are that they're not going to like really change in the near future, right? So most of them are like static assets. You can cache them. You can cache fragments. You can cache if you're like using like HTML include tags and things like that. So You can cache all those header fragments if you're sure that those fragments aren't going to change in the near future. So the rule of thumb is that, well, I'm caching them, so I don't really care. They're never going to change, so I can cache them safely on the client side, right? That's the whole rationale.
Can you create exceptions? For example, we have some profile picture.
Okay.
And you want to create an exception that this image should not be cached. Can you do that?
Yeah, you can. You can do that. You can't do that on your browser, but you can ensure that you don't set an expires header on that content when you're sending it down from your asset server, right?
Won't that be set for all emails?
No, you can actually set an exception rule in Apache where you can say, okay, I don't want to do this for this particular wildcard of, or maybe you deploy it in a separate directory, right? So you know that certain content is not really very static, so you don't want to kind of cache that content. So you just don't cache items in that directory. The way I usually do it is I put most of my static content in one static directory and cache the whole directory, so I know that everything that's coming from that directory is kind of cached. Right?
So why not just query?
I'm sorry?
For particular email, he's asking,
right,
why not just query with some instant time or something, so you don't just cache that?
Why can't you? Or
append a query.
Append a
query? Yeah, I'm fetching it on the It's
okay.
It's one of the directory for which you already cached.
Okay.
It's accept one of them. Just change it. So
okay.
It's going to still name myname.jpg.
Okay.
That's what we cached.
Right.
That's what we cached.
Right.
They're already right. But
right.
It's going to name one, the same name.
Right.
But you just create a query saying that myname.jpg query.
No. Okay. I'm not sure if you can kind of,
can.
Right? Yeah, you can? Okay, yeah. Well, you can do that in Apache, that's what she's saying.
Yeah, so for anything that you don't know, it's going to flush it.
But I wouldn't really, because if I'm actually going to write a query and query most of my assets, then that's going to be a performance overhead on my server again, right?
No, what I'm saying here is, something that we do is, let's say you have a
couple.
Yeah, so when you change,
okay.
Let me get the xname.jpg and you put a dot with the timestamp when it was last modified.
Okay.
The URL automatically changes when the server.
Right, so that's what we talked about earlier. We talked about static assets. So how do we kind of ensure that the client knows that it shouldn't cache this asset again without the, we spoke about that. We spoke about adding version numbers to. So you're talking about timestamp, I just spoke about version numbers. So.
But version numbers.
Right.
What he's talking about is a particular asset.
I suppose you can. I'm not sure if you can actually query a single asset and see if that's changed. As far as a web server perspective is concerned, I'm not sure because I've not done it in Apache. Maybe other servers actually provide it. I'm not sure. If someone does know, so she said that it can be done. If you can elaborate on that, yeah.
I think in production you can just flush it. So when you have a new file, okay. Just expire
it. You can do that, but then that will have to. Yeah. Okay. I suppose it can be done. I haven't done it per se. Right, so. So this is what I was kind of talking about, right? So this is like where you actually set a cache on your entire asset directory and you cache everything that is coming out of the directory. So you could have style sheets, you could have JavaScript, you could have images in that directory and you kind of aggressively cache everything. Right? So you set something like access plus 1 month or access plus 1 month, 10 days, or whatever it is that you want to kind of set on expires. This is not really specific to caching, this is specific to compression, but I've just kind of put that there to kind of illustrate how compression is kind of done. So that's about caching. Any other questions you have with respect to caching? If I do know, then I might answer. Yeah.
Let's say
we
have a flow.
Right.
You said that you need to pitch first step. When you go to setting of that page, your static objects, they get cached, right?
Right.
So from an HTTP request, if you go to an HTTP S request,
right.
How do you handle the HTTP request? Like few browsers, they have problems like
I
send a request to server and then go to the SS.
I believe the domain name changes, I think the request will be cached. Because as far as I know, that even the protocol actually constitutes part of the domain name, I don't know. Yeah, so what the question was, if you're actually coming from HTTP protocol and you're actually moving to HTTPS protocol, how do you ensure that the asset is still cached? But the thing is that you can have an HTTPS page, but your assets can always be fetched from an HTTP page.
Yeah, then you have to
exclude that. Right. So, CSS and everything that requires goes back to someone and fetches it. it's not loading.
If you change the protocol, it will consume the domain name change.
So
is
there a way I can
see? There are two things. Normally, when we do it, you would normally serve assets, CSS, JavaScript, pages from different domain altogether.
Right.
And that if your server by default is runs in HTTPS, you run that also in HTTPS. Not because of caching issue, but essentially because of the fact that when HTTP content comes on an HTTPS page, you get this warning, this page has
unsecured content.
It's mainly because of that. So if you want secure site, have your assets come from a secure server.
Right.
It's nothing to do with caching. What he's saying is, right, if a domain name is different, the cache can
be. So your protocol actually constitutes a domain name. So whether you say like you could say HTTP, you could say HTTPS, you could say HTTP or whatever it is, the protocol constitutes a domain name. So that's part of the whole unique key. That's part of your key value scheme if you actually look at it as a key value scheme, so this domain name, this asset sort of thing. So the minute you change that, it's constituted as a different domain. So if you're actually requesting, so if you ask HTTP example.json.com, some JavaScript from json.com, you suddenly change them to HTTPS and it becomes json.com, that's automatically refreshed again because the browser thinks that that's a different domain. It's actually
no workaround?
Well, the workaround is that you deploy that content again on the same, on the older non-secure domain. And it will kind of give you that warning saying.
But it will still reload the asset.
No, it won't. Not if the asset is being reloaded from your non secure domain.
Chrome basically, you know, whether you set an expiry or not, or whether you allow caching, Chrome by default is not caching.
Okay.
That is why it is faster.
Right.
But other browsers, at some point, they need to specify that this particular function has to be cached or not.
That's more of like a browser related thing. So what I understand is that you're saying that if you use Safari and you're serving secure content from a secure domain and you're serving static content from a static domain. So your older static domain. When you're saying that the static content is reload, I'm not sure if that's working in Safari.
I think we didn't really answer that question of if your static is on a HTTP server. When is requesting HTTPS?
I'm
sorry.
Right.
I think we didn't really answer the question.
I'm sorry.
I think we didn't really answer the question.
You didn't really answer the question.
I think we didn't really answer this
question. I didn't really answer this question.
He's saying that, like you said, that you don't come across this problem.
No, I'm saying that if you serve content from the same domain, it will cache the content. It's not going to not cache the content. So if Safari is not caching the content, that's the problem with Safari. Because most Firefox does cache the content.
No, only in case of HTTPS.
I know, I am talking about if you're serving content from secure content from an HTTPS page and you are serving assets from a non-secure page. Firefox does cache the content. If Safari is not caching it, I'm not sure why Safari is not caching it, but Firefox does cache the content.
Okay, I think just to add, I'm not 100% sure if I'm right on this. There's a fundamental difference between HTTP and HTTPS, the fact being on HTTPS content. The intermediate proxy servers cannot cache. Now, if you look at the internet, it does not mean that it's coming directly from the US to your house. There are a lot of intermediate servers in the process, proxies. So, if it's an HTTPS content, they won't cache it. That's the default rule.
They don't see that. So, you can see this when I come on my ISP and open. Actually,
it's only a deposition. Intermediate cannot cache.
You could have asset caching, you could have separate asset caches in between your origin server and your client.
So proxy, like, you know, all of the use proxies in our college to get rid of those kind of proxies.
Yeah.
They actually, you know, cache content at their server levels and they pass it on to them.
Yeah, because if your secure server caches doesn't have a certificate, they really cache that, right? It's a key request.
Exactly.
But S3 management has no mind, they have it. So what happens is you actually, when as a developer or as a production house, you deploy only once at one place called S3 or
right.
And the DNS, it's not the servers itself. The DNS
Between all the HTTP requests and chunk. What you get in the user is a browser, it's actually HTTP.
I think we're trying to take this discussion outside. We can, because we have like quite a bit of kind of data. Yeah. So we were talking about cookies and so ultimately we are looking at reducing overhead, right? So another really interesting way in which you can reduce overhead is to limit the size of the cookies that you're kind of using. So I know it's kind of conventional, a lot of people store a lot of stuff in cookies, but there are kind of very schools of thought on how much you should store in a cookie and how much you shouldn't store in a cookie. But the rule of thumb is that you do keep cookies as light as possible, because with every HTTP request that's made, your cookie is mapped overhead to that entire request, right? So it's appended to your request header, and then it's like packet forth to the request that you can make. So the idea is you keep the request payload as light as possible by, well, one of the things that you can do is reduce the cookie size, right? And it's also interesting that if you're actually deploying content on a separate asset server, you can actually make those asset servers not use cookies at all, right? So if you're actually deploying content on an asset server, then you don't really need a cookie to kind of you can like really have maybe like really lightweight or things like that. So because there's no real function of a cookie as far as an asset server is concerned, you're just deploying assets and you're just getting assets back. So that's another way in which you could actually reduce request overhead by that. So cookies are great, that we spoke about, right? Yeah, and cookies, like everything else, works on a domain name basis. So when you're actually talking about a domain, you're actually talking about protocol, you're talking about subdomains, you're talking about domains, you're talking about the entire thing, right? So the entire whole 9 yards. The idea is that you can actually minimize request weight by setting cookies at the appropriate subdomain that you want to set it on, right? So you don't need to set it at the top level domain or something like that. You can set it on a lower domain and things like that. So you can set a cookie on the domain where you actually need the cookie functionality. Right? So you wouldn't need a cookie functionality if you're actually kind of serving up static. So I think we're kind of way off schedule, yeah. So that's cookies and there's images. So you can actually cache images, and we spoke about it, right? There's also something called as image compression, where you can actually optimize images to be stored in a particular way. So the deal is that which image do you actually use? So that depends on what you want to actually kind of do. So more often than not, PNG 8s are like the favored images, because one is when they're cross-browser compatible, we can't really get rid of the whole IE6 demon. Right, so if you're really not targeting IE6, then you can go ahead and use PNG24s. But if you're actually targeting IE6, then you need, because PNG24s don't render in IE6, they render with a gray background, transparency not rendered. Why do we use PNGs over GIFs? We use PNGs over GIFs because PNGs support alpha transparencies, GIFs don't. It's a Boolean transparency, so it's either completely transparent or it's completely opaque. So there's no alpha transparency as far as the GIF is concerned. JPEGs are more or less like photographic images, so if you're kind of really displaying an image with a lot of colors, then you probably use a JPEG over a PNG, because PNGs are way heavier than JPEGs. Compression on JPEGs is like really high, right? So progressive JPEGs versus baseline JPEGs, which one do you use? So progressive JPEGs are like the image loads and you see like a very basic bitmap of the image, and then kind of progressively loads over several scans. But if you're talking about baseline JPEG, you'll just see like the JPEG loading in lines. Which one do you use? It's more of a usability perspective, whether you want your user to actually look at, to get a preview of the image so you can decide if that's what you want, that's what he wants to see or not. These are like a few ground rules as far as keeping page weight, and as far as containing page weight. So we have 2 minutes. Yeah. So keep your markup clean. Don't write like unclean markup, dirty markup, not standard compliant markup. That's like really important, because your browser actually has to battle with non-standard compliant markup, right? So there's actually no amount to which I can actually emphasize markup semantics, right? So that's like by far one of the most important things. Follow HTTP semantics. Use HTTP the way it's supposed to be used. Like, don't use a post instead of a GET. Don't use a put instead of a POST and things like that, because that's kind of just confuses the browser. Most of y'all have, I don't know if you've heard of this whole fave icon thing, right? How many of y'all have actually heard of it? Right. So that's the little icon that sits on the top left corner of your address bar, which kind of shows what the page is, right? So the browser by default makes a request to that web icon, right? And that actually sits on the in the root of the server, right? And there's no way you can actually prevent that. So please deploy that icon, because that's just one additional 404 if you don't deploy that icon, right? So we spoke about transparency. So don't do things like using alpha image loaders, right? Because that really kills performance. It's bad when it comes to loading. It can actually freeze up your entire load. So it's not that your assets will not load, but your assets will not render if you're using it. Until the dependency of the alpha image loader kind of is met, your page will not render. So you will have simultaneous requests being fired, but it will not render. Right? Ajax get versus post prefer. I prefer get, because post uses a two-step process. Get doesn't. Get is a single-step process. It's cacheable. Post isn't cacheable. Right? So at the end of the day, it's like, yeah. So this is all the usual stuff, like CSS at the top, JS at the bottom. Why do you use CSS at the top? Because, well, you can progressively render your page, right? So if you put CSS at the top and JS at the bottom. JS at the bottom because scripts kind of block other requests from kind of loading. Right? So, yeah, that's the end of the presentation.
We have about 5-10 questions.
So if you have questions, you can, yeah, we can take that discussion now. I just kind of run through it, right? Yeah. Yeah.
Just adding to that question,
yeah.
Someone has tracked an offline taxi.
Okay.
It's manifest crime.
Okay.
Does that manifest crime solve this HTTPS problem?
No. Manifest. Again, one, the problem you will not use this is the fact that it's not supported by many browsers.
Yeah.
Leaving that aside, actually even as something coming out of an HTTP manifest is much slower than your browser caches it. So the browser has the normal cache, so the thing is, the browser actually is, for 10 years or 15 years now, the browsers have really become smart at figuring out if the content is changed or not, whether to make a request or not, and put it from their local cache. Now, HTML5 cache is kind of all brand new and stuff. So today what happens is, there's a lot of latency. Even though it does not make a request, but the visitor is not optimized enough that you get a response quickly from your manifest. And manifest was not made to store CSS and JavaScript. It was made to store data of your client on the say for instance your username, your password, not your password obviously. Your username, your current score level, you are playing some kind of game.
That's local storage.
It's kind of the same thing, right? They're all very similar. So it was not made. People use it for storing CSS and JavaScript, but I mean it's actually not made for that. You can do it, but it's not really optimal.
My question was more in context of a mobile site that we created for Android. So Safari and
Yeah, if you're targeting that, you can definitely use it. For instance, there's
some other of my question was that someone is trying to manifest and it's come across this video and then
what's the
manifest and it's talking about this problem.
It's not a solving problem, right? When you're offline and you don't have access, for instance.
Not offline, so if you're using a manifest file. What happens is if you are still online, the request will not go to the server, right?
I'm not sure.
Something that you should probably go try and research on.
Yeah. I mean, the example I know is there's something called timezone.com, which is a very popular, which you can check out about timezone, is the time difference between me and Red. When I'm offline, I can still open their page and it's still there. So check, they use the offline storage manifest or whatever the thing is. And it's primarily targeted for iPads and iPhone users. Yeah, so it has their own uses, right?
Yeah.
But when you say you're still online, is it still fat? I'm not sure. Right?
Yes, it does catch it. But if you're online, you like to still load your assets to use the manifest file.
If you're online, your program can do a lot more intelligent stuff. Why are you really worried? You can see if you can get this online cache.
So there's a like good latency between the HTTP page and then the phone. Everything reloads, so let's say if you don't penetrate 5-6 seconds, you are again spending 5-6 seconds to load this video.
That's because you're cheating. Like I said, I haven't
done some activities to try out.
Yeah.
The thing is that, HTTPS side means it's a secure side.
Right.
You not want to, cache the
secure. That's precisely what I was saying.
So you would want to reload the entire page, because it's a secure side.
So page you are reloading. My question was just in context of this SSH.
No, why would you deploy assets on the secure server? I've never really seen any use case.
So you need to JS and CSS on the secure
server. Right, so you can always serve that up from a static from a non-secure server, right?
Yeah.
The reason why we would deploy assets on a secure server is nothing to do with performance, caching, and blah blah blah.
Right.
It's simply because
you don't get that
data. User will, you know, he suppose he goes on a secure site, he opens his bank website, you know, for instance. Right. This thing is coming from some non-secure thing.
Right.
The user will see this ugly looking warning that says this.
Do you want to see the non-secure content on this page? Right.
Yeah, it's scary to use. Yeah, that's the only reason.
Right.
Nothing to do with performance.
So if you're answering, if you are already intent on still caching that content.
Yeah, I'm going to something. You said use alpha 3.4 bit PNG when you're targeting I6.
Right.
I would like to add that a little bit more there. I think you talk about Optiv image PNGs
right.
Also. If you have that option, why is 3.4 bit when you print?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch your question. Can you come again?
So if you're targeting websites, unless you're targeting your retina display of iPhone.
Okay.
Why use alpha 24 PNG when that's going to be like 10 times heavier than
Webby?
I-bit PNGs. We would do it for 6 color.
Why use 24 bit PNGs if you can use
it? They said using 24 bit PNG, you're not targeting 96.
Right.
So
if like assuming that you do have a use case where you do need to kind of display a transparency with higher than 8-bit colors, right? So if you're talking about an 8-bit transparency, at best you can see 256 colors. That might not always be the case.
Right? Yeah.
So you might have and JPEGs don't support transparencies out of the box, right? At all. So if you're talking about higher compressions, you could use JPEGs. But then your JPEG doesn't really support a transparency. So there's no other way to kind of go but use a, or you could use an like a, yeah. So if you are using a 24-bit PNG, then you have to do something like using an alpha bootloader if you want to kind of still fall back or provide a consistent interface for 96 browser, right? So I believe the market share is still, I think, some 6% or something like that. It's not something that you can act. I mean, you can say, no, I'm not going to target for I6, I'm not going to. People can just upgrade their browser, but that's not really, I mean, that's not something, that's a very subjective topic. So.
And also the color difference between different PNG.
There is a lot of difference in compression. PNGs offer much higher compression than JPEGs, by the way. Yeah. So if you're actually talking about like a limited color image with a transparency, I probably
assuming we understand all of that, I was just debating between 8-bit and 24-bit.
Right. So I told you, like maybe you have a use case where you have to display an image with higher color.
No, the use case is that on the website,
right?
On all browsers. Till now, it hasn't come up to a stage where you really need to rely on 24-bit alpha PNG because you can optimize that to reduce 256 color of alpha PNG and stream is the same. Your eye cannot detect it.
It can't detect it, but that's what I'm saying. I'm saying that why would you use it? I mean, it's a special case scenario where maybe the color content of your image is so high with a transparency. So maybe you do have a semi-transparent image that you do want to show. Maybe. I'm talking about it on a per use case basis. It's not a generic statement where I'm saying that you have to use 24-bit PNGs across all browsers. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that for most common use cases like icons or menu items or whatever it is, backgrounds, you would probably use an 8-bit PNG. You wouldn't use a 24-bit PNG. But that's a very, very specific use case where you cannot do without using the 24-bit PNG. So if you're talking about an image with a large amount of color, you just use a JPEG. You wouldn't use a PNG in the first place because JPEGs are about one-third the size of PNG, right? So a full color JPEG is about one-third the size of a PNG, right? So
I think it will depend on how your color is arranged.
Yeah. But it's a generic statement. I'm not talking about that one specific file wherein you're saying that, okay, it's not one-third, it's one, maybe half or like one-fourth. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a generic figure. Okay?
So,
yeah.
Clear out my
doubt. Thanks.
Thank you.